Hi students, welcome to the session of the day. Already we have learnt about ophthalmic prisms. Now just I will recap about ophthalmic prisms and what are all the important points. Let us see in detail in this. And this will be a part 1, and in your part 2 we will see about the calculations which has to be made in resolving and rotatory prisms. So let us see that calculations in the next class. Before going into the calculation, you should know some of the theoretical orientation in this ophthalmic prisms. So, hope I can start now. The first thing, what is ophthalmic prism? You have all learned a little bit in your first year. A prism is defined as a portion of refractive medium bordered by two plane surfaces which are inclined at a finite angle. So a plane medium which has been inclined, at a angle, at a position. It has two portion, as you know already. One is base and the other is apex. So in the apex there has been an inclined with an angle, that is called a finite angle, inclined at an angle. The angle between the two surfaces is called as refracting angle or apical angle. So at the apex there will be an angle, the finite angle, that is called as refracting angle or apical angle. That angle is positioned at the apex, hence it is called as apical angle, and the refraction also takes place in that apex, hence it is called as refracting angle. And the next one is a line bisecting the angle is called as axis of the prism. The opposite surface of the opposite surface is called the base of the prism. Hope you have all learnt about this few. When prescribing the prism, the orientation is indicated by the position of base. So by the position of the base where it is located, that may be either inside or outside or upward or else downward. So according to the position of the base, the prisms are prescribed. So the four positions of the base is called as base in, base up, base down and base out. Next one, a prism consists of two angled refracting surface, as you all know about this already. The simplest form of a prism is two flat surfaces that comes together at an angle at the top. So where the apex is located, a flat surface that has been inclined at a finite angle, as I already told that position is called as apex. The top of the prism is called as apex, and the wider bottom of the prism is called as base, which is a little bit rough surface, right? So that is called as base. So look at this diagram. Hope you can understand through this diagram. So the apex is placed at the top of the prism, and the apex producing the angle is called as apex angle or apical angle or else refracting angle. The next thing is the base. Look at the base, that is downwards, and look at the ray diagram. When the ray incident on the prism, it gets deviated from its position. So that deviation from the position of the ray is called as angle of deviation. Hope you can understand through this. And the two plane surfaces with the same medium, that is called as N1 and N1, and inside the prism there has been noted that N2 is greater than N1. N2 is nothing but the other side, which is after the prism, one air medium will be located, right? So that is called as air medium or else some other medium which has been according to the positioning of the prism. So that is called as N2. And N2 will always be greater than N1 in case of prisms alone, okay? Then now refraction through the prism. So how does a refraction happens in the prism? Light passing through a prism always obeys Snell's law of refraction at each surface. So when the ray incident on the prism, it always obey the Snell's law at each surface. It has two surfaces, right? So in the both surfaces it obeys the Snell's law of refraction, hence the angle of deviation has been produced. the ray is deviated towards the base of the prism. Note in your mind, keep it in your mind, this point, the ray is always deviated towards the base and not towards the apex. Okay, the ray gets deviated towards the base. Okay, this causes the object to be displaced away from the base of the prism towards its apex. So, and also note down this one, the ray gets deviated towards the base, but the image gets displaced. The object producing the image gets displaced towards the apex. Hope you can understand this one. So the ray gets deviated towards the apex, but the image gets displaced and forms the image in the apex region. Okay. So this is the net change in the direction of the ray. Look at the ray diagram. The ray gets deviated in the base position, but the object is viewed at the object is displaced at the apex position. That is nothing but when we are just for an example, if you are wearing a prism that is in a spectacle, over spectacle mounted prism, so your prism is placed only in the half of the portion of the spectacle. That is, for example, from the pupil to the temporal side of your eye size, frame size, only half of the portion your prism has been placed. So when you are looking into the part of spectacle other than the prism, so the image, where the position of the image is there, that will be your visual. So when we are looking into the prism which has been located after the pupil and the temporal side, that half portion, when we are looking into the prism, due to the action of the prism, the ray gets deviated at the base area. So if the base has been positioned at the pupillary area, so keep it like that. So when the base has been positioned in the pupillary area, so the rays gets deviated at the pupillary area, but the image gets false or something dislocated in the temporal side. Can you understand this? If not, please play back and go through that again. Next one, all varieties of spectacle lens has the effect of a prism when viewed through a point away from the optical center. So when the prism is viewed from the optical center, all varieties of spectacle has a prismatic effect. Okay, when we are viewing through the optical center alone, we can visualize everything easily. Hence, the optical center has a power of the spectacle, right? So the optical center has the spectacle lens power, and the other portion, outer portion, has the prismatic effect. Further away from the optical center, the greater is the prismatic effect. So that is very necessary to give the correct, appropriate, and not approximate. It should be appropriate and it should be correct. Pupillary size and IPD, that is IPD, and optical center while you are dispensing your spectacle. If you dispense the spectacle without checking patient's IPD, then they will experience a greater prismatic effect. So this is very important to note down while dispensing. The next thing, for a prism in air, the angle of deviation is determined by three factors. As we all have learnt in our class itself, this is just in a recap, okay? The refractive index of the material of which the prism is made. So the refractive index should be important of the prism, for the prism, and the refractive angle of the prism. So the refractive angle, that may be determining the angle of deviation, and the angle of incidence of the ray. So where does the ray gets incident? So that is the important point. So according to these three factors, the angle of deviation is determined. Next one, light rays entering and leaving a prism are bent towards the base of the prism, as we have all learnt already in the previous slides. This causes the object to be displaced away from the base of the prism towards its apex. So, base down prism, upward image has been formed. Base up prism, downward image has been formed. Opposite, it is an opposite behavior. So, to the right or left, when we see through a base out or base in prism. So, when you base in is nothing but towards your pupil. Okay, base out is nothing but away from the pupil. Okay, can you understand what is base in and base out? Everything is same, base in or base out or base down or base in, everything is same. So towards the pupil, pupil away from the pupil. Okay. So this is just a ray diagram of the prism and which depicts about the image formation, that is base in, base out, that image formation. The next one is characteristics of prism. A prism has the thickest edge, the base, and a thinnest edge, the apex. So the base is thickest portion and the apex is the thinnest portion. A prism displaces the incident rays towards the base of the prism. So, the ray gets deviated towards the base alone. That is a characteristic, major characteristics of prism. A prism displaces the image towards the apex of the prism. A prism does not change the vergence of the rays. So, keep it in mind. So, the vergence of the rays doesn't change in prisms. A prism does not magnify or minify the image. So, when you take up convex or concave lens, what it does? So, convex lens, it will give a magnified image. And in case of concave lens, it will give a minified image, right? So, in case of prism, there will be no magnification or no minification occurs. Next thing, a prism also disperses incident pencil rays into component colors. So, in prisms, what we gain is, hope you have all learnt in your first year, Wibgeor formation, right? So, color formation may occur, that is dispersion. Dispersion may occur. Okay, components of color, that is a Wibgeor formation occurs. So this is just another ray diagram traveling in a different direction. So the rays traveling in different directions according to the apical angle and the incident ray deviation. So look at the deviated angle. So how much it gets deviated? Look at this. And the next one is angle of minimum deviation. For any particular prism, the angle of deviation D is least when the angle of incidence equals the angle of emergence. Refraction is then said to be symmetrical and the angle is called as angle of minimum deviation. So if the prism has angle of deviation D, that is least, when it will be least? So when the angle of incidence equals the angle of emergence. So angle of incidence is equal to angle of emergence. Hence there will be a least angle of deviation. Can you understand? So when the symmetrical angle, when you look at this portion, there will be a same angle has been produced. And this is called a symmetrical angle. And this is called as angle of minimum deviation. How will be the image formation in prism? So the image formed by a prism is erect, virtual, displaced towards the apex of the prism. There are two primary positions in which the power of a prism may be specified. The position of minimum deviation, the Prentice position. So in two primary positions, the power of the prism may be specified either in the degrees or in diopters. Okay, yeah, this is the thing, the units of prism. The power of a prism can be expressed in various units. The first thing is prism diopter. The second thing is the centroid. So what is a prism diopter? A prism of one prism diopter power produces a linear apparent displacement of 1 centimeter of an object situated at 1 meter. So when a prism produces a linear displacement of an object of 1 centimeter, when the object is positioned at 1 meter, 1 centimeter of displacement has to be produced in an object. Then that is called as prism diopter, and it is denoted by the symbol triangle, that triangle symbol. So look at this ray diagram. That is a depiction of the above mentioned thing. So what is the displacement produced? So look at the height, look at the upper and lower, which has been mentioned in centimeter. So that much of displacement deviation occurred. Okay, that much of deviation has been occurred in the 1 centimeter displacement occurred in 1 meter of object situation. So in case of 2 meter, there will be 2 centimeter of displacement. When the distance increases, the displacement also increases. When the distance decreases, the displacement also decreases. It is proportional to each other. Okay, the next thing, the centroid. This unit differs from the prism diopter only in that the image displacement is measured along an arc 1 meter from the prism. So arc, that means a degree. Okay, the centroid produces a very slightly greater angle of deviation than the prism diopter, but the difference in practice is negligible. So the angle of deviation produced has to be accounted along with the prism diopter, that 1 centimeter of displacement, that is called as centroid. So it is nothing but, we have already seen in the last slide, that is how do we calculate the prism diopter. 1 meter of positioning of object will produce us 1 centimeter of displacement, that is called as prism diopter. And in case of centroid, we also account the angle of deviation that has been produced along with the displacement position. Okay, can you understand what I'm saying? The next thing is refracting angle. A prism may also be described by its refracting angle. So it can also be expressed in refracting angle positioning also. And the next thing is deviation produced by a prism. This is the Prentice rule. Look at the formula. So prism diopter is equal to C into F, is known as Prentice rule. Keep it in mind. This is very, very helpful for your university examination also. The deviation so produced can be measured by the Prentice rule. So prism diopter is equal to C into F, is commonly known as Prentice. So what is C? Equal to image displacement in centimeter. So how much of the displacement has been made in the prism calculation? That is C is image displacement. That may be either 1 centimeter or 2 centimeter, something like that. And F is nothing but the lens power, the power of the lens. Or else if it has given in a focal length, then you should convert into lens power 1 by F and then to be expressed in diopter. Okay. So one thing you should note in that C should be mentioned in centimeter alone, not in a meter or else in a millimeter. Okay. The next thing, prism orientation. So how does the prism gets orientation, which means a positioning. Positioning of the prism. Prism can be oriented in front of the eye using a notations base in, base out, base up, base down. All other base directions require 360 degree notations. So in case of cylindrical power, what we are giving is 180 degree to from 0 to 180 degree. So in case of prisms, there will be a full rotation, which is a 360 degree. Okay, so look at this image. This is base down, the first circle. This is base down, and next one is base up, and this is base out, and this is base sorry, this has been something confused. Basin, they have missed to give. So basin should be given here. Basin is nothing but you should just oppositely keep it for right eye and left eye. This should be given. So in case of this is considered this thing in as eye. So base down. So that circle is pupil. So towards the pupil, that should be apex. That is called base down. And towards the pupil, and look at the second one, that is the base up. The base should be placed to away from the pupil. And next one is base out. The base should be placed away from the pupil. And the next one, base in should be given. Base in should be placed towards the pupil, not away from the pupil. You can gain some knowledge in this. So this is base out, base up, base in, base down for right eye and for the left eye. So this can be very useful for you people to understand the orientation of the prism. And the next one is uses of prism. Prisms can be used either for the diagnostic purpose or for the therapeutic uses. Let us see in detail about each. The first thing is diagnostic prism, assessment of squint and heterophoria. So prisms can be helpful for analyzing or for measuring squint and heterophorias, especially heterophorias. Measurement of angle objectively by prism cover test. So for prism cover test, you can measure the angle objectively. And in case of Madox rod, you can measure the angle subjectively. To assess likelihood of diplopia after proposed squint surgery in adults. So after squint surgery, you can assess diplopia by using the prisms. And you can measure fusional reserves, fusional virgins, something, that test and all. And next thing is 4-diopter prism test, FDPT, analyzing or for assessing microtropia. The next thing is assessment of simulated blindness. If a prism is placed in front of a seeing eye, the eye will move to regain fixation. So to fixate an object, the eye will take up a movement. This will indicate if the eye has been put on blind or it has, by simulating it, we can understand whether the eye is getting vision or not. So when we place the prism in front of the eye, seeing eye, the eye will move towards the fixate the object. So the next one is forms of prisms used in diagnosis. So what are all the forms of prisms? Single unmounted prism, that is first one which has been shown. Prisms from the trial lens set, you have all seen in your trial box, right? So that thing. And the prism bars, these are the bars composed of adjacent prisms of increasing powers. So from the least to the highest power, prism has been placed according to the power arrangement adjacently. So look at the down image. You have all seen in your clinics also, preclinical labs also. The next thing is therapeutic prisms. So in which therapy we can use a prism? So that may be either vision exercises or for spectacle uses, something like that we will see in detail. First thing is convergence insufficiency. Commonest therapeutic use of prism in orthoptics for building up the fusional reserve of patients with convergence insufficiency. If a patient suffers from convergence insufficiency, we can use this prisms to gain their fusional reserves. That is used in orthoptic clinics. And base out prisms are used in exercise periods. They are not worn constantly. So this should not be worn in constant manner. That should be only used in exercising purpose alone. So while exercising, we should use the prism as base out. Next thing, to relieve diplopia in certain cases of squint, include decompensated heterophorias, small vertical squint and some paralytic squint with diplopia in primary position. You will learn something more in detail about these type of squint in your future classes, and I won't go in detail about this now. This will be a little bit difficult for you people to understand. And then prisms are reserved for those patients for whom surgery is not indicated. So if the patient for mild deviation, they should not require that much of surgery level, or the patient who may not who is not willing to do surgery also can jump into prisms over their spectacles for relieving their diplopia. And forms of therapeutic prisms. First thing is temporary wear. Prisms used in treatment include clip-on spectacle prism for trial wear. Example, Fresnel prism. So that should be pronounced as a Fresnel prisms, or else a Fresnel prism. That is according to your according to the British slang or American slang. You can use any of this. So if the prisms has been placed as a clip-on spectacle prism for trial wear, that is called temporary wear. So first thing, Fresnel prism. To understand how a Fresnel prism works, imagine cutting off the top of large number of equally powered prism and gluing them one above the other onto a thin piece of plastic. So you can understand by seeing this. Okay, look at this image. This is the Fresnel prism. Equivalent solid prisms has been pasted. First thing has been sliced and pasted, glued accordingly. So this is called as Fresnel prism. This is very thin prism which has been used as a temporary wear. And this is only 1 mm thick in nature. And it consists of a plastic sheet of parallel tiny prism of identical refracting angle. So hope you have all used that 3D imaged scale in your childhood, right? So how that will be, it will be very thinnest appearance, and there will be a lines in it. So have you all looked up into that? So as like that, the Fresnel prism also has a nature. So the overall prismatic effect is the same as that of a single large prism. So the prismatic effect of the prism won't change, of the Fresnel prism won't change. That will be similar to the single large prism. The sheets are lighter than a glass prism and can be stuck onto the patient's glasses. So it can be pasted over the spectacle or used as a clip-ons. This is very helpful for the patient and just very lightweight. So this is the image of the Fresnel prism. So look at the spectacle mounted Fresnel prism. That is a very thinnest appearance. And look at the lines over the Fresnel prism. So the power has been arranged. The next thing is advantages of a Fresnel prism. It is very thin and extremely lightweight. So for their lightweight capacity itself, this is very advantageous. It has very over advantage than the other. It is flexible and can be applied to an existing spectacle lenses. So the other thing is it can be applied over a spectacle also. This is very biggest advantage of the Fresnel prism. It can be cut to any shape with the scissors or a razor blade. It is easily cut. It can be easily cut by using a scissors or a razor blade, and hence no further surfacing or that is not necessary to take into a laboratory for making the Fresnel prism to a desirable shape. And it can reduce the magnification differences considerably. And when you experience a magnification differences, this Fresnel prism can reduces it considerably. The next thing is disadvantages. They are harder to clean than conventional lenses. So due to their appearance of that rough surface, it is harder to clean. It might also cause some of the discomfort while viewing through the Fresnel prism. Fresnel prisms also causes a slight loss of visual acuity caused by the reflection for the prisms greater than 10 prism diopter. So when you are going into the higher prism diopter, that is greater than 10 prism diopter, the visual acuity will feel a slight loss in visual acuity caused due to the reflections of the over placement of the prisms. And when we are using the Fresnel prisms, so when we have to use high amount of prism, so when the patient requires high amount of the prism, Fresnel prisms are the best choice for to prescribe. Use and reuse. So we can also give this as use and reuse. This is like if they get adapted with the Fresnel prism, they can use that, they can continue using that. So we can give like that. And sectorial application, if the patient has homonymous hemianopia, that may be either vertical homonymous or else horizontal homonymous, sorry, hemianopia, vertical or horizontal. So we can give the prism as sectorial, which means a part of the Fresnel prism has to be fixed over the position of where we get blinded. So in that place we can place the Fresnel prism. And what is the nature of the prism actually is, it will relocate the image, right? The apex will relocate or dislocate the image formation. So in the blind spotter, in the blind area, which you don't get any visual stimulus, so this prisms will eventually dislocate your image and increases your field of vision. The next thing is slowing of nystagmus. So nystagmus can be slowed down by using this type of Fresnel prisms. Okay, first thing we have all learnt about temporary wear. In the temporary wear, Fresnel prism has been gone through. The next one is permanent wear. So prisms can be mounted in spectacles permanently. So look at the image, look at the right one, upward placement and downward placement of the prism, it is called as a sector prisms, sectorial prisms. Prisms can be mounted permanently for the patient's purpose, that may be either for field expansion purpose. Next one is vector addition of prism. Sometimes a patient require a prismatic correction in both horizontal and vertical direction, that I was said in the previous slide. This can conveniently be achieved by using one stronger prism mounted at an oblique angle. This is calculated by vector addition, either graphically or mathematically. So by using the vector addition through graphical or mathematical method, this prism has been placed towards their sector, either horizontal sector or vertical sector. The next one is Risley prism. So this is very important for you people. This will comes under in calculation purpose also. So please understand about this Risley prism. There is an application of obliquely cross the prism that is used on a regular basis in ophthalmic practice. That application is called a rotary or Risley prism. So oblique placement of the prism on a regular basis is called Risley prism. Okay, a rotary prism is a combination of two prism. So combination of two prism is called as Risley prism or rotary prism. These prisms are placed one on top of the other. Initially, their base directions are exactly identical, but as the prisms are rotated, their bases move by equal extents in opposite direction. So look at if we can better understand about this in the next slides. So look at this image. This is a example for Risley prism. So what happens in this ray diagram? So when the prism has been placed equally. Look at the second one. If the prism has been placed same, identical, then the ray formation is equal. When it gets tilted or it has been placed upward or else in opposite direction, that may be not that much clear for us. So this is an example. For example, suppose two prisms of 10 prism diopter, each are placed on top of one another. So base to base has been placed. So remember this, base to base placement means that will produce the total prismatic effect of 20 prisms. So we can base to base placement result in 20 prism diopter. So if the patient needs 10 prism diopter, we can give the rotary prisms as 5 base and 5 base. So the combination of the both prism will produce the 10 prisms, right? So in case if we place base to apex, then their total prismatic effect is 0. Okay, so the prismatic effect will be 0 in base to apex placement. This has been given in this Risley prism diagram. Next one is, how do we interpret of orthoptic reports? First thing, one prism diopter is equal to half degree. Half degree, which means 0.50 degree. Okay. Example, 20 degree is equal to 40 prism diopters. Can you understand this? So one prism diopter is equal to half degree or else 0.5 degree. So 40 prism diopter is equal to 20 degree. Prescription of prisms. Generally, when prescribing the prisms, the correction is split between the two eyes. So the apex of the prism must always be placed towards the direction of the deviation of the eye. So first thing, you should look out where the eye gets deviated. That may be either exo or eso, hyper or hypo. Towards the deviation, your apex should be placed. Can you understand this? Next thing is convergence or eso deviation. Keep it in mind, these things. Convergence or eso deviation. So eso deviation, that is towards the nasal deviation, nasal part, nasal area. Base out prism should be placed. Example, 8 prism diopter base out, right and left. Can you understand this one? 8 prism diopter base out should be placed in case of eso deviation. That is just an example. So base out should be placed in case of convergence or eso deviation. Then in case of divergence or exo deviation, base in should be placed, that is in opposite direction. So base in should be placed. That is an example given in 6 diopter. Base in, right and left should be placed. Next one is vertical deviation. Vertical is nothing but hyper and hypo, that is upward or downward, right? To correct the vertical deviation, the orientation of the prism is opposite for the two eyes. So when you correct vertical deviation, the orientation of the prism is opposite for the two eyes. So what we have seen in the last two thing, that is horizontal deviation, same prism orientation for both the eyes, for the right and left eye, base in or base out. So in case of vertical deviation, that should be opposite. Okay. Next thing, the example has been given. 2 base down for right eye and 2 base up for right hypertropia. So look at this, base up for hypertropic eye, that is when your deviation is towards vertical part, that is upper area. In that case, base up is given. Which eye has been affected? For that, base up has been given. And for the other eye, which is normal, base down is given. Can you understand this? So this is just a diagram. note this one. Next thing, prisms in optical instrument. So where we are using the prisms in optical instrument? First thing, slit lamp biomicroscope. Next one is applanation tonometer. Next one is keratometer. And the placement of the prism, either right angled prism or poro prism or dove prism. So right angled prism is nothing but the prism has been placed at a 90 degree. So look at the A diagram. So one prism and the other prism. So that has been placed in 90 degree vertical direction. And poro prism is nothing but image is inverted and it has been placed towards 180 degree. So when the incident ray falls on one prism and it gets reflected towards the other prism, and your reflected rays will get image formation in the other prism through the other direction. So that is like a mirror image of your C, right? And the next one is dove prism. Dove prism is nothing but apex has been removed of the downwards prism. So image formation, image is inverted 180 degree and is reversed. Okay, that is apex removed prism, dove prism. Detection of prism in optical lenses. Hold the glass up between the eye and an object which forms a straight line. If the continuity of the line is broken as seen in figure, it implies that the prism is present. And since the line appears to be deviated towards the apex, we know the direction of the apex of the prism. The amount of displacement produced is the strength of the prism and can be measured by neutralizing. So by neutralizing, we can calculate the amount of displacement and the strength of the prism which has been produced, amount of displacement. And we just hold the glass between the eye and the object, which will form a straight line. And if the line is broken, let us see in next slide. So look at the image. If the line has been broken, then there is a presence of prisms. So we can understand this. If the line broken, there is a presence of prisms. To do so, put the prism lens off. This is for neutralization purpose. How to neutralize a prism? To do so, put the prism lens of known strength in contact with the lens under checking with its apex in opposite direction. So we are going to neutralize the prism. How do we calculate? The first step is we should keep the lens which we have to neutralize at the bottom, and over that we should place the neutralizing lens, that is apex in opposite direction. The apex should be placed in opposite direction. Then the next thing is the prism lens with which the continuity of the lens again established. So the broken line that should come into a continuity of a straight line. So when it comes to a continuity, then we got a neutralization point. You can understand. As we do for spherical and cylindrical lenses, the same thing for this also. Look at the distant object by placing the prism over your eye, and you get some incontinuity in your image formation, and place the prisms in apex opposite direction, so you can find out the power. Where you get the straight continuity of the line is called the neutralizing point in the prisms. The next one, you can also calculate by using a lensometer. I don't go into deep about this because you know about the automatic lensometer and also the manual lensometer. So in that, there is an option. In automatic lensometer, there is an option called prism dioptric calculation. So in that, we can calculate the prism. Thank you. This is end of the session. And in next class, we can calculate about the... We can learn how to calculate the resolving power of the prism.